Welcome, everyone, to Westcliff University's Distinguished Innovator Speaker Series. And our fourth speaker in that series, Steve Ecclesine. And Steve and I will be talking about his amazing career as a producer in the entertainment industry in just a minute. And we'll also be discussing opportunities in Hollywood and how to go about actually getting a job in the entertainment industry. I'm Barry Sandrew, and I'm Director of Entrepreneurship at Westcliff University, and I'm your moderator today, and I'm really very happy that you are all able to join us this evening. We'll get to Steve in just a minute, but first I want to briefly introduce Westcliff University to those in the webinar audience who might not be familiar with the institution. Pictured here is our campus in Irvine, California. Westcliff is an accredited private institution with approximately 3,500 students enrolled both online and face-to-face on campus. There are four colleges. The College of Business offers bachelor's, master's, and doctoral degrees in business administration as well as certificate programs. The College of Education offers a BA, a master's in teaching English as a second language in the Real Intensive English program, as well as certificate programs. The College of Law offers a Juris Doctoral degree and certificate programs. And finally, the College of Technology and Engineering offers a BS and MS degree in IT, an MS degree in computer science, and an MS degree in engineering management. For more information on the university, I invite you to visit our website at westcliff.edu, as well as Westcliff University on Twitter, Facebook, and of course, LinkedIn. And now for just a little bit of housekeeping, you've all joined this webinar in listen-only mode, which of course means you're all muted. But I welcome you to use the question plane to on your screen to participate in Q&A, and I'll be posing as many of those questions to Steve as possible as we get on with our discussion. And now I want to introduce a good friend of mine, actually, Steve Ecclesine. We've known each other for a long time. Over the past three decades, he's worked with many notable directors, including Roger and Gene Corman on The Slams and Airwolf 2 for Universal USA, as well as Sliders, the Sliders TV series for Fox. However, as a serious film buff that I am, what's most important to me is Steve worked with Orson Welles on his last film, The Other Side of the Wind. Now that film premiered last year on Netflix. And Steve was actually featured in the documentary about that film. The title of the documentary is They'll Love Me When I'm Dead. And I watched it for a second time last weekend. And to our webinar audience, if you have a chance to watch it, please do so. It's actually much more interesting than the actual film, although Steve may disagree. In a strange way, the documentary is what Orson Welles hoped the film would turn out to be. And I want to ask Steve, right now, I mean, let's do a split screen. So Steve, tell me about, I mean, it's amazing that you were actually an editor with Orson Welles and that film was mind blowing, the fact that he actually wanted it to be a movie within a movie. I don't want to get too deep into this, but it's just fascinating to me. He wanted it to be a documentary about a guy who was making a movie. So it would be both. And it turned out after he died that that's exactly what happened, correct?
Yes. It was very strange that upon my arrival in Hollywood that the only job I could get was as an assistant editor for the Roger and Gene Corman, who are famous in show business for producing 20 films a year. And they gave a lot of famous film directors their first chance to make a movie, like Francis Coppola or Martin Scorsese. And when you make 20 movies a year and you're trying to do it for as little money as possible, you're looking for talented kids who show up with a lot of passion and drive, and you give them a chance to go make their $20,000 or $50,000 or $100,000 movie. So anyway, that was what I started off with as an editor, and I learned that craft. Then through a lucky set of circumstances, I ended up being Orson's editor for 2.5 years. And we did a couple of different projects together. One was called F is for Fake. This one that landed on Netflix is called The Other Side of the Wind. And that only took Orson 9 years to make. He kept shooting and kept shooting and finally ran out of money. And so it was finished. And this was The Other Side of the Wind, which is what Barry was talking about on Netflix. But as he said, my belief is that the documentary that was made about Orson's life is called They'll Love Me When I'm Dead. And it's very enjoyable. It's an amazing capturing this mythical beast called Orson Welles.
Yeah.
And there's this brand new film that's just shown up on Netflix called Mank, which was done by a very famous director, David Fincher. And it's black and white, and it stars Gary Oldman. And it's basically the story of the writer of Citizen Kane, a guy named Herman Mankiewicz. And mm-hmm. So the name of that film is Mank. And once again, it's an interesting look back to another era in terms of how films.
Oh, yeah. And there was a controversy over whether who actually wrote that thing.
Sure.
There always is. Steve, one of the fascinating things about your career is the fact that you've done 700 television shows. And I don't think one would think that it's impossible for anyone to do that many television shows in a career. How did you manage to do that?
Back when I first started, once again, and I didn't know what I was about to do was impossible. So I just went ahead and did it. And I was 26 at the time. And I found myself in the right place at the right time, whereby doctors, airline pilots, and lawyers were lining up to get a 7-to-1 tax shelter. It was a tax shelter scheme, if you will, whereby I went off and in 3 years produced 540 half-hour TV shows. And these were pretty much, you ganged up the shooting sequences so that I was on a stage and was shooting 5 half-hour shows a day. And they would always, the people with the money looking to get their tax shelter would wait till October the 1st to commit. And at that point, I had 90 days to knock out between 140 and 240 television shows between October the 1st and December 31st. And the films had to be registered in the Library of Congress. So I would have 3 stages going every day with 5 half-hour TV shows being produced on each stage. And these were singing shows and kids shows and all sorts of things. So anyway, that's how I did the bulk of them back when I was a kid. Then I got older and I ended up doing 16 movies and a bunch of more television shows, things like Airwolf and Sliders. Mm-hmm.
And how many movies for HBO you did simultaneously?
We did 5. We shot 5 movies in 6 months. This is, once again, nothing that intelligent people do. It's just crazy people like myself who would say, sure, let's go do that. And we wrote the scripts and built them in such a way that we shot for 18 days with the same crew. All the 5 movies had the same crew, and each film had a different director and a different director of photography. Mm-hmm. And so it was 18 days of shooting, 5 days off. 18 days of shooting, 5 days off. So we managed to knock out 5 of these things in 6.5 months. And for anybody keeping track, my favorite one is called She Creature. And you can find that on Netflix or Amazon or something.
Yeah, they were all horror movies. Yeah.
And they had Stan Winston creatures. Stan Winston was the gold standard for mm-hmm. creature production. Things like the dinosaurs in Jurassic Park and Scissorhands with the scissors and all that stuff. So anyway.
Very cool.
They turned out well.
Yeah, and You've also produced a number of music-themed productions, including Chasing Happiness with the Jonas Brothers for Amazon Prime, Demi Lovato, My Truth, a documentary for Google and YouTube that follows Demi through, 20 concerts in 30 days? That must have been a pain. Must have been really difficult. But, yeah. Go ahead.
I am basically a dyed-in-the-wool independent producer. I've worked for the studios. I've worked for every major network. But I seem to be happiest in situations that other people avoid because they're smarter than I am. So I basically get an opportunity. When they don't have enough money, then they call me and say, can you do this for not as much money as the other guys wanted to charge? And I'll figure out a way how to do it. And yeah, they're happy.
So we don't have a budget. Go call Steve.
if it's too much, call Steve.
Yeah, go. Well, this year, Steve, you produced 15 Justin Bieber 2020 dance videos for YouTube, and that generated over 80 million views in 4 months. And we've got one of those videos, and maybe we could take a look at it. David, could you play that video?
And I'll tell you to just keep your eyes open, watch the camera work, because it is spectacular.
Yes.
Never ungrateful for it. That's how we both want it. Habitually. Can't nobody keep me like you. Call it unconventional. I love it's habitual, yeah.
Beautiful. Steve, and originally that was a single camera shot.
It is still one camera shot. What we saw yesterday was kind of a choppier version, but that was the single camera shot.
Oh, good, good.
So okay, we did two takes of that, and we did the first one. I mean, it took us 4.5 hours to get everybody going. The 15 Bieber videos were shot in 15 days in 15 different locations with 15 different dance crews. So the dance crews got the music 2 days before they were going to be on camera. The choreographer and the dancers had to figure out what they were gonna do. And then they would show up at the location. We would work out the logistics of where to put the camera and the lights and everything. And we knocked out 15 of these in 15 days. And Barry, it's over 90 million views at this point.
90 million.
These 15 videos.
Steve, and there are producers, and then there are producers. And the producers, the first ones, are the ones that sit in a chair and smoke cigars all day. You're not that.
No.
Explain your role in something like this.
In this case, I got to play, in different shows, I play different producer titles. This particular role that I was called for was called a line producer. And the line producer is responsible for hiring the crew, hiring the, getting all the equipment lined up, getting the locations, the catering, all the mechanical aspects of what was required each day to shoot. And that's basically what a line producer does if you see that credit on any show. Whether it's a big time movie or a TV series, a line producer is the person who is pretty much the master drill sergeant, who's in charge of all of the elements that go into making this a nice, smooth running day every single day. And that you've got to get, in this case, I needed to get a 4 minute dance number in the can every day. This was the only one of the 15 that was just a single camera. All the rest of them were multiple cameras and multiple angles and normal coverage. This just happened to be an artistic choice made by the director, and we just made it happen.
Incredibly difficult thing to do. How many takes were there to get this? Only two.
Yeah.
Wow, that's amazing.
So in the first one, there was a little camera bob as the cameraman with the Steadicam was following the dancer up the staircase to get to the main stage. And so the director said, we need to do it again. So we shot it again.
You know, in the way you were describing a line producer, it brings me to really one of the main focuses of this presentation today. You know, underlying all the perceived glitz and glamour of the entertainment industry and behind the cameras, there's an elaborate manufacturing process for producing movies, TV shows, commercials, and music videos. And there's a worldwide audience with a voracious appetite. And, you know, while the actors and directors and most of the producers get most of the attention, there's literally an army of professionals with a wide spectrum of skill sets who are essential to any successful production. You actually, you know, recognize that, and you actually wrote a book called So You Want to Be a Producer. And it's a definitive book on the art and business of feature film and TV production, and is currently being used as curriculum in film schools around the country. Could you tell me why you actually produced that and also, you know, what other skill sets are vital to a production like that?
In regards to the book, if you really want to jump into show business, you'll find all kinds of biographies about famous people. You'll find all kinds of magazine articles and extra and all that stuff. But I didn't, when I looked around, I didn't see anything that resembled the Boy Scout handbook for people who want to get into show business that would hopefully, and what I did was I took what I consider to be my diploma from the University of Hard Knocks and basically wrote it down into 140 essays, figuring that this would go to 150,000 people who are in film school right now. There's probably another 500,000 who want to go to film school. And it was designed basically to detail out a lot of the unwritten rules of show business, things that you learn the hard way. And I'm trying to make life easier for the people who followed me so that they could read this particular book and at least understand who the players were and how the players worked. And as best as I could try to inspire people that if indeed you wanted to jump into this shark tank, which it is, I tell them it's a 5-year fist fight in the foyer to determine whether you're gonna stick around in show business. But it's gonna take you that long to make a bunch of friends, meet a bunch of people, sort of suss out where you fit in the overall scheme of things. Because you're coming up to an intersection that says show and business. As I said to Barry before, that these are two drunks holding each other up, trying to get home. And you can't have one without the other. So people who just focus on the show, they need to understand the business side, and the business side need to understand the show. And they don't traditionally get along all that well, because eventually there is risk involved. And at that point in time, corporations and other people who have attempted as best as they can to mitigate that risk, sooner or later it becomes defined and they say, you know, it's time for me to leave this discussion because it's now going to cost me money that I don't have a guarantee that I'm going to get back. So it's a business that attracts a lot of gamblers and that's on the show side. We got tremendously, wonderfully genius, brilliant people who are coming up with stories and are wonderful writers and directors and actors. But over here, there's this whole other part called the business side. And on the business side of show business, there are a myriad of places where a person who is a business-minded individual could look at to find out if they have what it takes to get involved. In the show side, the business people that I'm having to contend with all the time are, there's a production accountant who has to, I have to work with as the producer and make sure that I've got all the allocations of the budget in the right place and all that. And they're going to keep track of the money, and they're going to report back to the people who gave me the money as to how, what kind of a job I've done. The other principal job on a of a business kind of a nature is that of a what's called a unit production manager. And this is a person who is in the Directors Guild on the major studio networks and TV shows and that sort of thing. Oftentimes it's the line producer who also gets a double duty as the unit production manager. And the unit production manager is in charge of the budget and working with the director. The first AD works with them on the schedule, but basically the unit production manager is like the master drill sergeant in a military operation. And they're responsible for the budget on a daily basis. And they're another person that I'm working with because we're hiring the crew and the equipment and all that stuff. So consequently, I wrote the book in order to try and lay out a playing field that people could plug into and start to understand the language, because every business has its own language, its own acronyms and shorthand. And so I tried to lay this out in a way that people could dive in, take a look, see if this was something of interest to them. And on the business side, now heading over here to the, let's say, executive suites, you've got all kinds of business analysts and accountants and people who are in charge of the overall budget for the studio. You know, a studio might have 750 million dollars this year to spend on original productions. So now each of the shows that are vying for that money have got to come and prove themselves. And you know, a package gets put together with a director and these stars and this story, and decisions get made in the executive suites. And a lot of times the individuals who start off over here in the business side end up running the show. You can look at the major studios and you'll find that a lot of the people who are up at the upper echelons of vice presidents in charge of production and marketing and whatever, but they started in the accounting department. Or business affairs and things like that, which if you're a business-minded individual, it's a wonderful opportunity. It's brutal. I mean, you know, I came to the realization very early on that 85% of the seats on the bus were taken before I got there. And the same thing in any job in show business, 85% of the seats are already taken. So you just got to get in there and prove yourself and identify an area that you really love, because that's what show business is all about. It's about finding your passion. It's about finding something that really turns you on and makes you want to jump out of bed and do your job every day.
You know, my son, Jared, he was a freshman in college, and he decided he wanted to take off a year and see what he can, I mean, basically see what he could do in computer graphics. He was into computer graphics. And I called up my friend, Steve Ecclesine. I said, Steve, Jared wants to get an internship where he can actually get some experience. And Steve called up a friend who was basically a one-man show working on a whole bunch of Disney television shows and put my son in there. My son really knew nothing. And eventually he ended up doing all of the special effects for Just So Raven and a whole bunch of other Disney shows. And now he's one of the most sought after visual effects artists in the industry. And he's also done the last 7 Disney feature films in terms of 3D. But what does someone who doesn't have a dad in the industry and doesn't know Steve Ecclesine do?
The internet is your absolute be all end all best all tool to find things out. And there is a thing called IMDb. It's called the International Movie Database. And if you just dial up IMDb, it's a treasure trove of information. You can dial up any picture you ever saw and you wanted to find out who the director was or the writer. You can dial up anybody's name in show business and they'll give you their resume. So it's a terrific tool to find out information. And what it also, there's a second tier, of course, that's free. And the second tier, which is called IMDb Pro, you can subscribe to. It's a very nominal fee, I think 10 bucks a month or something like that. But it has the listing of every single studio, every single network, who the players are in each of those places, plus their email address and their phone number. Now, this is material that was really always kept very close to the vest before the internet, but here it is, and it's readily available, if indeed. And so predicated on which arena is exciting to you, I always say you don't write a letter to the big shot director because he's not going to get it and he's not going to read it. So what you do is you're looking at the credits for a show that you really loved, whatever it was. You look for the associate producer name or a co-producer or a line producer. And they're not getting 1,000 emails every day. You're basically contacting them to say, I have an interest. I would love to learn more about this. Can I buy you a cup of coffee? Because my take on people in show business is you don't really exist until you sit across the table from someone to see how crazy they happen to be in show business. Because this is not a job for like normal people, I don't think. They're very smart people. And there's a lot of subjective, the entire industry is built upon subjective opinions of what's good and what's bad. Yeah. A friend of mine read an article in the LA Times about a dolphin that had its tail cut off in a net down in Florida. Now, this is in the LA Times, in the Sunday section, and they basically outfitted this dolphin with a prosthetic fin so that it could go back and released into the wild and swim. So anyway, 2 million people read this story in the LA Times. Probably 2,000 people in show business said, wow, that would make a good film. Then probably 150 of them sort of looked into it a little bit farther to find out who's... Two people called up the guy who wrote the story, and my friend was one of them, and he ended up getting the rights to this particular story. He then sat down, wrote a script, he sold it to Warner Brothers, and it became this movie called A Dolphin's Tale. And I have heard of a myriad of different situations like that, comparable to that, whereby somebody fell in love with a story and decided to take it and make something happen. So I would look at in going back to the IMDb Pro, you can get vice presidents in charge of accounting, you can get a financing of legal affairs, business affairs, all sorts of things that you can find out by going over here to this IMDb Pro, and you send out your 25 resumes or your 50 resumes, and maybe one person answers or two people answer. Okay, fine. You're looking for any angle you possibly can to kind of get in to meet somebody who's going to help you. And a lot of times in this first, what I call this 5-year fistfight in the foyer, it's be prepared. Things are not going to go exactly as you planned because they never do. And it's like once you're out there, you intern. If you possibly can, you find a company that's making shows that you really love. And so you've tracked down who the production company is because their logos are on the 3-second at the end of every show. And you track down who then, you go over to IMDb Pro and you check out who's the person who's in charge of financing or accounting or business management or legal affairs or whatever, anything. And you've now got their email address and you say, I want in. I'm ready to do anything I possibly can to take what I've learned in school and apply it to this thing called show business. And a lot of times in that 5-year fistfight, you might have started off in saying, I want to be a director, which most people in show business want to be. And basically, as you get into the mix, you say, you know, I really love the sound of the music part. I really love the sound part. I really love being a cameraman or whatever, whatever. And then it gives you a chance to kind of like, that's your, almost like your general practitioner. And then you get to go be a specialist.
So. Yeah. One young woman at Westcliff came up to me and asked my advice. She was into College of Business, but she really, her real love was in editing. And she learned on her own. She learned After Effects and Premiere, and she was editing a whole bunch of videos. And she had she created a reel just on her own, not for any other reason. And she said, "How do I do this? How do I get into the business?" And I basically told her what you said. Hollywood Reporter used to have everything that's on IMDb, but it's all on IMDb right now. And what you have to do is, correct me if I'm wrong, but you contact them. You'll work for free. I mean, my son worked for free as an intern, and he made it in the industry.
Worked for free.
Yeah, that's the way the industry actually works.
What they did with, in my particular case, and the thing that's fascinating from a totally objective perspective is every single project is different from the next. And every single project, if it's got this cameraman and that leading actor, it's going to be look this way. If it's got a different cameraman and a different leading actor, it's going to look that way. So it's understanding who you are, and the fact that if indeed you really want to get into show business, understand that probably about 90% of the people who know you say why, and what kind of a masochist are you? And because it doesn't make any sense to jump into off the cliff and hope there's water down there. But it's what we do, because this thing inside of us just won't let us rest and go.
Right.
And you oftentimes have to take other jobs that you don't want to take in order to pay the rent, keep the food on the table.
Yeah.
But you're going to learn from each one of these experiences that you go through, and you're going to take something that you're going to be able to use in your next job. It's just that each job is totally dissimilar to the next.
And I think that's probably the best way to go. You don't want to go to the major studios and try to get a job. You can, but, you know, if like this one young woman with editing, well, editors are a dime a dozen. The best way to do it is to look at a freelance career. I mean, a lot of that scares a lot of people, but I think there's a lot less stress. I mean, you've been a freelancer all your life. Right. And you've been very successful at it.
I have gone through the feast and famine cycle on many occasions. And I think I've been here for 50 years, and I probably worked 30 to 35 of those, which is a really wonderful ratio at the end of the day. But at the same time, that means that 15 years, I wasn't working. 15 mm-hmm. years, I was taking lunches, I was making phone calls, I was encouraging writers to write this story that I wanted. And so you gotta understand that, you know, when you're making a lot of money, set it aside, because there's going to be times where you're not making a lot of money. And you need to cover the bases for that particular time period. As soon as you get a success, you don't go out and lease the first Bentley or Rolls Royce you can get your hands on.
Right. I've gotten the impression with COVID and everything that the studios, and I mean the smallest studios, the smaller studios, are looking for less people with a greater range of skills. I think that this seems to be the era of the generalist in Hollywood. At least that's my impression. Do you agree?
I think that definitely things are changing. The entire marketing of your finished film is one set of circumstances that's undergoing a tremendous transition, because Warner Brothers has just announced that it's going to be releasing all of the 14 films it was going to be putting into theaters next year that they're going to be releasing them on HBO Max. Now, Warner Brothers happens to own HBO, so it's no like, how did this happen? they understood that. And the other part of the equation is that, like, for instance, Live Nation, which is a company that is responsible for all of the big touring acts that go across the world. And if it's YouTube or if it's Lady Gaga or whatever, and basically back 3 months ago, they pushed off everything from 2021 to 2022 because they didn't see the efficacy of putting acts into stadiums that could only put 20% of the audience in the socially distant in the stands. So they couldn't make the money off a 50,000 seat stadium if they only had 10,000 people there. Yes, they'd make some money, but they wouldn't make as much as if they had had the 50,000. So they have shoved all of their touring acts, their big touring acts, off into the summer of 2022. So that was done 6 months ago before there was any vaccine. So now that the vaccines are looking as though they are going to be landing with everyone before the end of the spring next year, it seems as though at least that's what they're telling us, that conceivably I could see these guys starting to line people up to have concerts in August and September and what have. But 6 months ago, this was their decision that nothing was going to happen to change them. So anyway.
Yeah, Tanya, who just asked, just made a comment, says, I tell everyone that I don't have a gambling habit. I just work in show business.
it reminds you of the other quote, which was, how do you make a small fortune in show business? The answer is you start with a big fortune.
So, that's a good one.
Yeah.
You know, Steve, we've known each other for decades, and I've never seen you so passionate about a project that you're involved in right now. You've directed an acclaimed Alzheimer's documentary film. And it's called Have You Heard About Greg? And it's a story of Greg O'Brien. He's the author of the best-selling book On Pluto, Inside the Mind of the Alzheimer's. And we've got a trailer of that, and I'd like to show that right now, if that's okay.
Sure.
You good? Good, David.
I've heard people from different places across the country and some foreign countries, and they can see their own lives or the lives of loved ones through this journey. And this journey is about living with Alzheimer's. I saw this journey as a window for the baby boom generation that they could look through my window and see things in their own lives in this disease that we need to bring out of the closet and talk more openly about.
Imagine, if you will, a terrorist organization announcing tomorrow that had a bioweapon that was going to infect 80 million people by 2030, 11 years from now. And can you imagine the globe's response to that proposition?
This is a quiet thief in the night that relentlessly robs from the patient the sense of identity, personality, and ultimately the very essence of self.
If we don't do anything by 2050, minimally 14 million patients in this country, it will single-handedly wipe out our healthcare system.
There were millions of people who are undiagnosed, who are walking around on the path to Alzheimer's.
Greg O'Brien has Alzheimer's, a lifetime journalist. He's written a book about what he calls embedded in Alzheimer's.
Anyone who's ever chatted with Greg knows that that's a real conversation, and it's heart to heart, and it's soul bared, and it's funny, and it's irreverent, and it's loving, and just brutally honest.
I believe that God, first of all, has a sense of humor, and God will talk to you in language that you just understand. I want a God like Coach Belichick. Do your job.
Well, as I tell the Patriot haters, if you lived in New England and had enjoyed six Super Bowls, you'd probably be rooting for the Patriots too.
Right, so there, okay, now I lost my train of thought.
Well, we're
have we met before? Greg O'Brien, damn pleased to
good
meet
to
you.
Good to meet you, Greg.
Alzheimer's, it's like having a sliver of your brain shaved every day. 60% of my short-term memory can be gone in 30 seconds. And every day is a fight for me. And I put a stake in the ground as a journalist and said, we're going to start to talk about it.
What about the kids? Alzheimer's is about the kids. It's about your kids, my grandchildren, and your grandchildren. And that's why we have to marshal the forces to bring this out into the public, to bring Alzheimer's out of the closet into the public like we did cancer and AIDS.
I feel right now, and I know others in this journey feel, that we have one foot in the next realm and one foot here, and I'm just waiting for the Lord to pull me over to the next realm. And he keeps saying, not yet. I go, well, how about today? Not yet. We're not done.
That's beautiful, Steve. And, you know, I expected to be very depressed after watching that. By the way, it should be mentioned that you grew up with Greg.
Yes.
Your families knew each other, and both your moms had Alzheimer's as well. So it's very, very personal to you. And I expected, again, to be very depressed by this documentary, but I wasn't. I left it with a kind of upbeat and hopeful, because he's dealing with it in such a courageous way, and he's addressing it head on. And I just think it's a beautiful movie, beautiful documentary.
I told the editor, who was wonderful, that I said that we made a feel-good movie about the most dreaded disease in the world.
Yeah, yeah.
And it came about, and as all these things come about, if you really dive down and sort of like find out what the genesis or the origination of this great story or that great story, I mean, this happened as a result of me going back to my 50th high school reunion, and I urge you to all go back to your high school reunions at certain decade markers, because it's wonderful. It's a wonderful opportunity to see how you're doing in comparison with all the other kids you grew up with. Anyway, one of them came up to me and said, have you heard about Greg? I said, Greg who? He said, Greg O'Brien. He's written this book about Alzheimer's called On Pluto. And I said, no, but I'll contact him. And we got in touch, and we hadn't talked to each other in 50 years. And it turned out he had been this wonderful investigative journalist and gone off and had his whole career. And I'd gone off to Hollywood and had my career. And I said, we found each other at a time when we could help each other. So that's the reason why I went off and made this particular movie, was because I looked around at the other Alzheimer's movies and the other Alzheimer's TV shows, and I saw an opening. Once again, just like when I wrote my book, I saw an opening. I realized an opportunity was here if I could capture the essence of what's going on to a newcomer who's coming to show business, because the stuff that I covered in my book is not the type of stuff that you get covered in film school. It's like, okay, once you've gotten out of film school, here's what you can expect. So this was just a golden opportunity for me to, Greg said, hey, I'm coming out to Scottsdale, Arizona to address 400 aging life caregivers. I said, great, I'll come with two cameras and we'll sit down and we'll shoot your presentation. And once I got to meet him again, now as an older person, I fell in love. He had a terrific message. He had the audience charmed, eaten out of their hands. People can't believe that he's been diagnosed now 10 years ago with pre-Alzheimer's. His mother had died, his father had died, his grandparents had died. He, of all of Alzheimer's, my mother died of Alzheimer's, and I hadn't paid any attention to it. So that's why I wanted to invest in this particular project. And it's going to find an outlet. We're talking to a couple of different distributors, and we're very hopeful that it's going to reach not only the 5.7 million people who've been diagnosed, but for every person diagnosed, there's 10 other people, family, friends, caregivers, whose lives are going to be upended. And so now you've got 50, 60 million people living in America who every day are thinking about this thing called Alzheimer's, and try to shed some light in it, offer some hope, and also some really good science and information about things that people just aren't paying any attention to.
Right. You directed and produced the
whole thing. I did, yes.
Yeah.
And so that's lovely. Are there any questions, Barry, that you've got that have been sent in as far as how do you get started, or what's the best way to?
Well, we got a lot of comments, but not a lot of questions about getting into the industry right now. I think you have one other video, right, associated with this?
There's the distributor, the would-be distributor, basically said, "Have you got a scene from the film that kind of captures the essence of it?" And I went and looked and I found a scene, and I basically pulled that up. It's a minute and 35 seconds. And I believe David has that in the queue.
This pretty woman, 20 years younger than me, waving at me. And
he's in the airport.
I don't care if you're Irish or Italian or whatever, you're gonna wave back, man. It's a pretty woman, you know? And she has a copy of Pluto. And I said, I'll be right over. And when I went over to her, she said, "I saw you on TV and I saw you speak." And she said, "I'd like you to meet my father." And she said, "I want you to know that my dad has Alzheimer's. And he wouldn't talk about it. He wouldn't talk to any of us at all until I gave him a copy of Pluto. And now that he's read it, he's talking for the first time about what it's like, because you took him inside the disease and made him feel it's safe to talk about it." And she goes over to him and says, "Dad, see that? This stuff doesn't just happen. Talk about God. See that man over there? What are the chances? That's the guy who wrote on Pluto." So he gets up and comes over. He hugs me, I hug him, he starts crying, I start crying, we start talking. It was like a spiritual thing.
Beautiful. Steve, I do have a couple of questions that are interesting. Is this what success looks like, to do projects like this, or how do you define success in the entertainment industry? I think that getting a paycheck is probably a success.
You know, it's either the money or the gold statues. You know, that seems to be what we're all sort of fighting for. I think I once upon a time saw Richard Dreyfuss explaining his career, and he said something that resonated with me, which is, we just hope to create a body of work that we're going to leave behind that other people are going to want to see 20 years from now, 100 years from now. To me, that's success in show business. There's a whole lot of stuff going on in show business that is forgettable, or you don't want any part of, or it's not going to last more than the time that it was on the screen. But I mean, you get known by what projects. My agent called me up today and said, "Hey, would you like to produce a variation of Big Brother?" I said, "No." I said, "You're known by what you do. And I don't have that many turns at the wheel left from my point of view. And I don't want to be off doing some crappy version of a crappy show," in my humble opinion. But nevertheless, I'm not a 20 something, and I'm not watching this religiously, but you know, it's got an audience. They've all got audiences. I mean, it's amazing what has transpired. But in terms of show business, as far as success is concerned, Barry, I just look at it as everybody's got an internal scorecard. And they understand how they're doing. Am I turning out A+ work and nobody's seeing it? In which case I need to get it seen. Am I turning out C+ work that a lot of people are watching because it's crap? And it's absolutely wonderful crap. But nevertheless, it's not going to change anybody's life, and it's just basically passing time for the zombie generation sitting around mm-hmm. watching their TVs. So I think everybody has got their own definition of what's successful. Some people say, "Oh, I got as soon as I made a million, I'm going to be successful. Or if I make a billion, I'm going to be successful." That doesn't mean you're going to be happy. It doesn't mean you're going to be passionately in love with your life or the things that you, how you pour yourself into it. Some people just have a wonderful knack of making money, you know, and that's all great. I think show business is, like I said, two drunks holding each other up, trying to get home in one piece. And you got to have the business people who understand the numbers and how all that stuff works between the financing part, as well as then the actual costs of production and all the thousands of lines of details of what you got to go through in order to get even a simple show produced. And then there's the aftermath of the marketing and how are we going to make our money back? I'll tell you a quick story. There's in the studio, within the studio system, there's a kind of an internal green light process. They take a project, which is this script and a synopsis. They say, it's this director, these two actors, here's our story. And then they hand it out to all the different divisions inside of the marketing arena. This goes over to the cable people and the foreign sales people and the streaming people and all the rest of it. And they all make a guesstimate of how much is this going to generate in our neck of the woods. And they come back in, and as soon now the accountants in the studio take a look and they say, the projections by these professionals say that we are going to get at least a 2-to-1 return on investment. And at which case then they basically give it a green light because they feel like their ass is covered and they're going to get this show produced and generate a revenue. And I remember when they did a projection in Warner Brothers for The Blind Side, which was a lovely football film, Sandra Bullock, Tim McGraw, taking a black kid and raise him, help him. And he finds himself out on the football field in terms of where he's going to fit in with the world. And their projection for domestic box office was $70 million. The film grossed $250 million. So Warner Brothers did the rare thing of going back to try to find out why were we so wrong? Because generally these projections by these different parts of the studio can come within 5-10% of what that film is going to gross in foreign territories, in the home video, et cetera. And they wanted to figure out, why did we get it so wrong? And they went back and they did some market research and they found out that it was families in the South and the Midwest that kept coming back to see the film 2-3 times and bring other families with them. And it was because in the final analysis, it was because this film, which was put out as a very commercial, you know, Main Street Warner Brothers production, had somehow told a story that embodied the Christian ethos, so that it just was woven in without anybody hitting you up the side of the head with a Bible or God or anything else like that. It just happened to work that this film basically put out the do unto others message. And that was what resonated with its audience. So the experts, these people who are inside the studio walls and are highly paid and highly respected, they have about a 200% batting average. About 80% of everything that they think is going to go off and make a bunch of money fails. But the money that they generate from the 20% that works pays for everything, pays for all the mistakes and then some, and keeps everyone gainfully employed.
Great. Steve, I do have one question about jobs again. Do you think that IMDb Pro recommendation applies to other avenues of the entertainment industry, such as marketing, music, supervision, finance, et cetera?
You have to do your homework. You have to, because each one of those that you just ticked off, Barry, is a different discipline. Is a different arm of the octopus. The music arm is different from the financial arm, is different from the marketing arm, is different from the business affairs people. And so it's kind of like when I go back to that 5-year fist fight, it's like I would venture to say that anybody who really, really, really wants to get into this business, it's save up enough money whereby if you don't have a dime of income coming in over the next year to year and a half, you should be able to tell within a year and a half whether you're cut out for this business. And just plan on not making a dime, plan on throwing yourself in front of as many different possibilities, and you'll find that there's all kinds of things happening that you can jump into. And if you really think it's music or marketing or financing or whatever, now you start looking at the credits. Now you start doing your homework. And if it's not, you know, each one of these studios have got divisions of people and they're always looking for people. It's not advertised. Usually, like I said, I go back to the 85% of the seats on the bus are taken. When they start looking for people, it's Joe's got a nephew, Mary's got a sister, somebody's, some wonderful nepotistic operation is going to be deployed, and those 85% of the seats on the bus are going to be filled up. But they still have this room, this other 15% of the seats on the bus, whereby they're looking for the bright, new, young, passionate somebody who's got an idea, who's got a Jones for making music, a Jones for they're fantastic with numbers and they can move through all kinds of spreadsheets very quick. Okay, great. There's a place for you to be found on the team. It's just you got to suffer a lot of rejection and you've got to be able to recognize an opportunity when it shows up in terms of somebody's willing to say, come on in, I'll sit with you.
You got to be proactive and have chutzpah.
Absolutely. So, and it's a tough one. It's like show business is much like wanting to be an airline pilot or wanting to be a doctor. It's as Barry well knows, it's a winnowing process. It's, you know, very, you probably get into this thing and it might be 5%. I'd go and lecture a classroom of 60 kids who had read the book or wanted to talk about being directors and everything. I'd say, look at the person on your right, look at the person on your left. You all want to be in show business. You all want to be directors or whatever it's going to be. I said, three of you will have a job in 5 years doing what you want to do. And the rest of you are going to find either something else to do in show business or you're going to get out and go find your way in some other part of life.
Well, Steve, this is exactly what I thought it would be. This is incredible. I mean, you know, I love the way you talk. I could listen to you, and I often do, to listen to you forever, typically across a table in a pub. But I always say that you should be in the radio because the way you talk and the way you go on is just remarkable. And I just love to listen to you. And I hope everyone else appreciated you as much as I do. I think they do from all the comments. So I really want to thank you for, not that you had a choice because I asked you and you wouldn't turn me down anyway, but I really want to thank you for joining us today. And,
thank you so much for allowing me an opportunity to, I always say when I go to a lecture and sit down and listen to somebody, I say, I hope I learned one thing. I hope I learned one thing that I didn't know before that will turn out to be useful or helpful to me in the future. And if nothing else, possibly I have scared some of you away. And that's sure. Okay. And you will find your niche. You'll find that piece of business that you love. And that really, if I can't say anything else, it's do what you love and you won't feel like you're working.
Great. Well, thanks. Listen, I want to go on to another slide before we say goodbye and to let everybody know what's coming up in the spring. We have a whole series of very interesting speakers, basically a rundown of some of the talks. But again, thank you so much. Appreciate
it. My pleasure. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So, well, as a matter of fact, I'm going to be speaking in January. I'm speaking on, the real title is Lessons Learned from Colorization of Black and White Movies and the 3D Conversion of 2D Movies, And what I learned from, which I invented processes for both of those, and what I learned from that and how I applied it to, or how I am applying it to immersive technology, in particular regarding storytelling, because Hollywood tried to embrace virtual reality for storytelling and it didn't work, and I know why. I've been pretty much accurate about immersive technology and how it impacts storytelling for at least the past 10 years. So anyway, I'll be talking about that. And then we've got some really interesting people. Deconstructing Harry Mollison's Brain, The History of Memory. This is a fascinating topic. It's about the most famous patient in neuroscience. He was always known as HM, and a neurosurgeon that I actually work with took out this part of this person's brain to help him with epilepsy. He had epilepsy all the time. And it was experimental. He took out the hippocampus and amygdala and he was fine. He had no more epilepsy, but he had no short-term memory. So a number of scientists built whole careers over decades testing this person. And Dr. Jacopo Annesi, who's the founder and executive director of the Brain Observatory, got his brain when he died, Henry's brain, and actually cut it up into 3,000 slices on the internet, believe it or not, because he had such an incredible audience because people wanted to find out what actually was going on in there and how it related to all of the scientific advances that were made by these other people. It's a fascinating story, believe me. We also have neuroscience of attention, how video games are used to study and treat attention disorders, AD, and HD and autism with Dr. Leanne Chikosky. She's at Qualcomm Institute, and she's also founder of Brain Leap Technology. And then we have blurring the lines between virtual and physical realities, the power of LiDAR imaging and photogrammetry. And that's Greg Passmore is an old friend of mine, but he's an absolute genius. And let me ask a question. What is a Czech Roman Catholic chapel made out of 70,000 human skeletons, the largest bat caves in the world, and the Church of the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem have in common? Well, they're all very fragile environments. They're probably some of the most interesting places in the entire world. And Greg has been able to capture them using LiDAR at sub-millimeter level, so you can actually go and explore them. And it's absolutely fascinating. It's absolutely beautiful to see. And he's going to be presenting as well. So we have a great lineup for the spring, and we have some others as well. On behalf of Westcliff University, I want to thank you all for joining us. Good evening.